The 2018-19 Tampa Bay Lightning are a rarity in a parody-filled landscape that is the modern-day National Hockey League. This year, unlike in recent seasons, the Bolts aren't just very good.
They score! Kucherov!
The most points ever in a regular season by a Russian-born player.
Nor are they just a cup contender.
The Tampa Bay Lightning, they tie the 1995-96 Detroit Red Wings with 62 wins.
They are an entirely different league. I'm talking the strength of 31 different teams in one.
Griffin? Griffin? Still traumatized by how little you know? He's been like this for about 3 weeks. He's made me tweet for him, post comments, text his mom to let her know that no, he's not a non-responsive, immature d***. Just don't know what to do with him. The only things he's responded to are, Yzerman's our GM, and Nick Leddy is overrated. That's my favorite one. I just can't imagine what's going through his head right now.
Around the clock, Panarin, and now Jones with a shot. He scores! Columbus has climbed that mountain, and now they're at the top. Centering pass along to Shane. Oh my goodness, what a goal! 5-1. Cross ice, centering pass. Bobrovsky says no. What a dandy, an Andre Palat. A four-game sweep by the Columbus Blue Jackets against a team that had all kinds of records this season.
Okay, I'm not that pathetic. Doesn't matter who's right or wrong. As long as the hockey's good, I'm good. Good? Hey, you got a lighter?
You ever bet on the NHL? Don't. Between all the brackets and playoff pools busted by this slot machine of a sport, we saw some damn good stories emerge from the 2019 Stanley Cup playoffs. You had the Avs just completely dominate the Flames in 5 games, with Nathan MacKinnon's line showing us we already knew but on a bigger stage. The Isles came out and held Sidney Crosby to 1 assist in 4 games despite being the third worst possession team in the first round. The officiating. Calder snub Miro Heiskanen was the best defenseman in a series where supposedly 4 of the best played on the other team. I didn't even play organized hockey at any level, but Rod Brendamore made me want to run through a wall for him every time he had a post-game pep talk in Winnipeg. Turns out it was the year of the Thrasher, and that the Jets didn't make it past the first round for the 18th time in 19 seasons as a franchise. They were sent home not by a Preds team out for revenge, nor a powerhouse Calgary team, or even a repeat Vegas Golden Hour. Nope. They were shut down by a team that was in last place on January 2nd, led by a 25-year-old career AHLer that was the 4th goalie on the depth chart coming into the season. Hockey, man. But the Columbus Blue Jackets sweeping the Lightning straight out of the first round to win their first ever playoff series? I still can't say it with a straight face, but yeah, it happened. That's hockey, baby. Tampa clinched their playoff spot almost a full month ahead of the Jackets. By June, that team could have the season's best coach, best goaltender, best defenseman, and, I don't know, league MVP clean up at the awards. That team tied the NHL wins record held by another squad who knew a thing or four about heartbreaking playoff losses. That team had the season's best power play and penalty kill, the best offense, the best statistical season by a Russian-born in NHL history, 340 goal scorers, the best season by a team since the NHL soundtrack was graced by Franz f***ing Ferdinand!
I'm telling you, Torts, they're unbeatable, they're They're unmatchable. They're Goliath. This is their time to win a Stanley Cup.
Well, you can't win them all. But it's not like the Jackets were one of those 8 seeds that went in deep for the sake of making it, despite knowing that there was a 100% chance of them getting absolutely dunked on. That's not a knock on their sweep, but rather a compliment to the strong foundation built by GM Jarmo Kekalainen's regime over the years. Besides, as one team falls flat on the pavement while all the hockey world points and laughs at them in their existence, another lands a complete 900, giving us a story that was a long time coming. Then again, you may ask yourself, for good reason, what the hell does Tony Hawk landing the first 900 in X Games history on a half pipe have to do with the Blue Jackets winning their first ever playoff series? Well, they failed a lot. Like, 10 bottom 10 finishes in their first 12 years of existing. A lot. Now, to be fair to inaugural GM Doug McLean and assistant Jim Clark, the Jackets were initially constructed from a position of weakness in the expansion draft. In 2000, the salary cap didn't exist, you weren't penalized for giving out no move clauses to good hockey men, and other teams could protect up to 15 players versus only 11 in 2017. This wasn't Vegas' Wild Wild West. Less cap-strapped teams and a lower selection of quality players equaled a roster featuring Jeff Sanderson, David Viborney, Ray Whitney, and a bunch of other guys that I swear were NHL-generated names, like, what? They were also put in the same division as the Wings, who had the Hockey Hall of Fame, and the Blues, who had big rough Keith Kachuk with his equally tough friends. You can understand why they got socked a few times. But that means better draft positioning, so, theoretically, things should have gotten better. But let me ask you something. What's the point of bruises if they're permanent? What I'm saying is if you suck and you don't hit on draft picks, you get it. 2001, Pascal Leclerc. He got hurt a lot, but let's be honest, he would never survive this mess. 2003, Nikolaj Zverev. Slick, but he never managed to get along with any of the 4 coaches he had in 4 years. Wonder why it didn't work. 2004. Who? 2005, Gilbert Brulé. Now here's a can't-miss guy that we can let simmer in the minors. Okay, he's playing fresh out of junior. Okay, he's hurt. Okay, he's back. Okay, he's hurt again. Okay, he's not playing enough. Okay, his confidence is shattered. Okay, he's an Edmonton Oiler. Okay, this was pretty unfortunate. 2006, Derek Brassard. Solid. 2007, Jakub Voracek. 2 in a row. Solid. 2008, Nikita Filatov. But those were just the first rounders. Let's see what they had outside the first round. Well, they got Rick Nash, but you can see how this would become a problem. With their prospect pool looking like an abandoned post-Olympic Athens drain show, the Jackets overcompensated in trying to artificially surround their lonely superstar. Basically, they bought the house and didn't have the furniture. Well, besides the thinking chair. It's a period in franchise history that I like to call Order 61. It had 3 phases. Get Rick Nash a center, fuck it, that didn't work, we need every guy that's ever played, and what if we did both? In phase 1, Doug got frisky in free agency, bringing in big-name centers like Andrew Castles, Trevor Letowski, Jan Herdina, and Mike Peckham. Remember them? Neither do I. They also traded for Sergei Fedorov, but we don't talk about that because it never happened.
Listen to the boos.
Nope, never happened.
The number 91.
No, never happened. Needless to say, this failed and it cost McLean and Clark their jobs. In phase 2, new GM Scott Housen managed to trade away 3 of the first 4 top 10 picks I mentioned, you'll notice a trend here, for every old hockey name that takes you back. I'm talking the days of Jim Hughson and Craig Simpson on the NHL games. I'm talking RJ Umberger, 27 goal man Rafi Torres. That's a real stat, look it up. Fedor Tuten, Jason Williams, Antoine Vermette, Christian Huselius, and Mike Commodore from free agency. All the glorious pronunciations. This shopping spree, coupled with an insane Calder heater from Steve Mason, actually got them a playoff appearance in 2009. In which the last great Detroit Red Wings team of the era said, "Welcome to the show, bitch," and promptly put 4 bullets in them. In phase 3, the Jackets were still without a top-line playmaking center known for his playmaking. So, Housen went out and got Jeff Carter, a top-line center, known for his goal scoring.
The team traded away Voracek, the 6th top 10 pick dealt in 3 years, to make it happen.
Housen then traded for James Wisniewski's negotiating rights and handed a 6-year contract to a power play specialist. I now appreciate the Ian White signing even more. Vinny Prosbyl then came in for a 1-year deal because really, why not both? Thinking they were going to contend, the team proceeded to crater into the center of the f***ing earth. Carter lasted 8 months before he was traded to LA in February. Voracek? Yeah, you're not getting him back. On top of all of this, Nash was finally fed up with sweating his prime on a team that couldn't surround him. Understandable. Privately, he requested a trade. Until Housen made that request public after he couldn't trade him at the deadline. Yikes. But we could see this coming. The Jackets already had years upon years of awful prospect development and an unstable carousel of 8 different head coaches. But instead of getting those issues in order, they decided to go all in from a position of desperation. Never a good idea. I don't fault Housen entirely, as there was probably added pressure from upstairs for him to get good and fast. The manufactured core, built on desperate trades and free agent signings, I'm sure had good intentions. But the road outside nationwide had been paved with those for years. The moves not only resulted in the worst losing season of 10 losing seasons in the franchise's 12-year history, but ended up pushing away the very core piece that they were trying to build around. They went all in, all wrong, and they were in desperate need of an organizational overhaul. Enter Mr. John Davidson. JD had inherited a similar situation in St. Louis 6 years prior. Dead last in 2006, he played an integral role in bumping them up to second best by 2012. Let's see. Yeah, the Jackets fit that criteria. The day he joined Columbus as president of hockey operations? Yeah, the NHL was still locked out, but the franchise started to gain that brain trust needed to build a contender the right way. Davidson soon brought on his first major hire in February 2013, firing Housen and bringing on Kekalainen as the first European general manager in NHL history. Previously, he spent 5 years as the assistant general manager with... Okay, that makes sense. He also served as the director of amateur scouting during his 8-year Blues tenure. If you're familiar with obscure names like Vladimir Tarasenko, Alex Petrangelo, David Perron, TJ Oshie, Ben Bishop, Carl Soderberg, and David Backes, chances are he had a solid influence in drafting them. Oh, and he spent, what, like 7 years in Ottawa while the team was drafting guys like Marian Hossa, Mike Fisher, Marty Havlat, Vermette, Jason Spezza, Ray Emery. But I mean, what did they do? After Yarmo, JD brought in Bill Zito, Wisniewski's former agent, to be assistant GM in August. A highly successful scouting mind, a staunch negotiator from the player's side on your side, these were the kinds of perspectives Columbus needed. While the new regime was forming, contributions from the previous one didn't go unnoticed. Housen's assistant GM Chris McFarlane was kept on because, well, he actually knew how to draft properly, and even Housen himself went out the door on a high note. In 3 separate trades, he gave Kekalainen young pieces like Nick Foligno, Sergei Bobrovsky, Artem Anisimov, and Brandon Dubinsky to play with. Pretty sure the first 2 became mildly important and the others became pretty useful. Could do without that cat pit, but nobody's perfect. McFarlane ran drafts that resulted in Cam Atkinson, David Savard, Ryan Johansson, Boone Jenner, Jonas Korpisalo, and Josh Anderson before JD came. After he arrived, he and the rest of the scouting staff continued to unearth guys like Alex Wenberg, Oliver Bjorkstrand, and Marcus Nudivara, on top of hitting on Zach Werenski as a cornerstone pick. Gradually, an organic core was starting to form. So naturally, Kekalainen traded Derek Brassard, another top 10 draft pick for Marian Gabrick, and another draft of this script was incinerated. I am not kidding. I spent almost 2 weeks on this thing. Thankfully. Outside of that, Yarmo let the nucleus continue its growth. He even mixed in a few savvy moves to support it. He turned a trade request from Umberger into 28 goals from Twilight Town Scott Hartnell. He also moved out Wisniewski's contract, gaining a pick and some much-needed cap flexibility for the summer of 2015. Speaking of Zito's specialty, he likely had a hand in helping Kekalainen sign Johansson, Atkinson, and Bobrovsky to team-friendly deals during the 2014-15 season. The results from smart people doing very smart and progressive things? Well, from 2013 to 15, the team posted not one, not two, but three consecutive winning seasons. Now, some franchises would file that under this is purgatory and you're fired, but keep in mind that they had a winning season before this. One. Uno.
Once!
Oh, can somebody get him, please? They even got their first two playoff wins in the middle of the year of this run, including their first ever at home. Even though they missed the postseason the other 2 years, there was definitive progress to hang their hats on. But then again, considering where they were, there could have been a temptation to fall into complacency with a nice little run of success.
No.
June 30th, 2015. Brandon Saad's about to get offer sheeted, until Kekalainen trades Marco Dano and Anisimov in a package for his negotiating rights. Wait, he's still an RF? No problem, 6-year deal. October 21st, 2015, the team has playoff aspirations after taking some much-needed baby steps. The team starts the season 0-7. But before we do anything too crazy, head coach Todd Richards has provided stability for the last 3 years as the winningest coach and team. Doesn't matter! Call the NHL Network and bring me torts! But didn't he start a off. January 6, 2016. Johansson for Seth Jones. The trade is 1-for-1. I haven't even touched my holster, and I have 3 holes in my chest. What is happening? These big swings, they weren't all different from the days of Order 61. But unlike his predecessors, Yarmo had the furniture. The core that was building allowed him to be bold with a purpose. He could afford to lose two pieces if it meant bringing in a prime young block in Saad. Unlike Ken Hitchcock, who came in to coach Nash and a bunch of acquisitions in 2009, Torts inherited a core of youngsters that he could grow with. As for the Johansson-Jones deal, honestly, that's just ballsy, man. It was a team need, but still, the cojones 4-for-60 on this guy. Am I right, advanced stats, guys? Too intangible, I get it. Recognizing the foundation his peers had helped build, Kekalainen supplied the aggressive mentality that was needed for the team to take that elusive next step. In 2016-17, they did. That year, the Jackets posted their first 50-win season in franchise history. They also put up a team record 108 points, 51 more than their second season when Ron Tugnutt was the goalie. There we go. Bobrovsky copped his second Vezina trophy in 4 years. Torts won the Jack Adams in his first full year. Jones had the first of his many Norris-caliber seasons, and he is just... God, is he so good! They also posted their first top 5 finish in team history, and they were a 3-seed in their own division because the Metro sucks, but who cares? In Season 5 under JD, the team was a legitimate threat in their conference, a legitimate Stanley Cup contender, a legitimate franchise in the National Hockey League. But, that didn't mean all the growing pains were gone. All their awards, all the records, all the winning, it was important, for sure. But all of that? For just 5 games in the playoffs? You know how that tasted? Stale! And what does Yarmo do when the thing gets stale? He trades very good player, Brandon Saad, who had 2 very good years, for Artemi Panarin. You know, a bona fide slam dunk Russian rock star, the most electrifying forward since 61 in its no contest, 2 seasons in the league, 2 seasons of 30 goals and 70 points, entering his prime at 25, that is certified fresh. In Panarin's first season with the Jackets, he set the team's single season scoring record with a fantastic 82-point performance. In the playoffs, he helped put the Jackets just 2 wins away from their first series victory in franchise history with an OT winner in Game 1. Everything is sweet, until it's sour.
Washington Capitals come from a 2-0 deficit to win 4 straight
And they will advance against the Pittsburgh Penguins, but a valiant effort.
4 games later, the Jackets were done again. The most successful run in franchise history. 0 playoff wins to show for it. They made the moves, had the team, had the series lead, and just couldn't stick the landing. Further adding to the disappointment, Panarin and Bobrovsky were entering contract years coming into 2018-19. Although we were told it wouldn't be a distraction, it sure felt that way. Panarin was still lighting it up and actually broke his own franchise scoring record with 87 points, but Bobrovsky was having his worst season in years and was actually sent home earlier in the year for cheesing out of a game early. 2 years after their best season in franchise history, the team was barely in the playoffs by the trade deadline. Conventional wisdom said, find the right deal for Panarin, reload on the fly. If only I knew then that Jarmo Kekalainen simply did not give a f**k about conventional wisdom. February 22nd, 2019. Vitaly Abramov, Jonathan Davidson, 2 first-rounders for Matt Duchene. You know, the best player on the market not named Mark Stone. February 23rd, 2019. Anthony Duclair and a couple second-round picks for Ryan Dzingel. You know, one of the best wingers on the market. February 25th, 2019. Adam McQuaid and Keith Kincaid for 4th, 5th, and 7th-round picks. You know, just in case. It did take a while for the team to gel after the moves, but they rattled off 10 wins in their last 15 to get the last spot in the playoffs. Their reward for making it? A date with a very good opponent. Nope, that's not what you said. A cup contender. Nope, better than that. An entirely different league. Yes, okay. Which, to be fair, is what Tampa Bay looked like after the first period of Game 1. But they, me, and everyone else underestimated how good the Jackets actually were. They had endured 2 consecutive playoff losses against the eventual Stanley Cup champions. And after years and years of failure, the poor drafting, the poor prospect development, wasting Rick Nash, seasons of sadness, off-seasons of apathy, the years of playoff disappointment.
He scores! He scores! What a goal by David Savard!
Josh Anderson with Savard. He'll cut through the slot. Anderson shot scores! Josh Anderson! Jones with a shot. He scores! They come all the way back. They get it done in Game 1. Werenski finds a hole right off the draw.
Tick, tack, and put it to the back of the net.
The league's best team in the regular season is down 2 games.
Down, but they score! Matt Duchene! Atkinson, bullseye!
It's up 3 games. The Columbus Blue Jackets do have a stranglehold on this best-of-7 series.
Score! Alexander Texier! Pierre-Luc Dubois! Oliver Bjorkstrand!
Bobrovsky comes up large. Shut down! Quality save! 72 will shut it down again.
Going down the gun, and they score! Artemi Panarin!
For the first time in their franchise history, the Columbus Blue Jackets have advanced in the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Now, the success was short-lived. The Jackets did lose to the Bruins, the eventual Eastern Conference champions, in Round 2, despite emptying all their bullets against the nuclear fallout shelter, aka Tuukka Rask, but I digress. Yeah. They only won a single playoff series for all the moves that Jarmo made. But before you question whether going for it this year was worth it, take a listen. You all better be taking notes. On the ice, Panarin, Bobrovsky, Duchesne, and Dzingel could all be gone by July. Off the ice, the uncertainty's even heavier. Davidson, the man who kinda saved the organization, went home to the Rangers to guide their rebuild. Zito is flirting with other employers, namely Seattle.
The offseason questions do hold weight. But really? Take what they're left with.
Yarmo hasn't exactly been a train wreck. Far from it.
Also, look at the core they're keeping. Atkinson, Pierre-Luc Dubois, Anderson, Bjorkstrand, Jones, Werenski pending his contract, Savard, Alexander Texier showed something in a limited sample.
Emil Bemström had a breakout year in the SHL and he's coming over.
In goal, they've got Elvis Merzlikins, Daniil Tarasov, and Veini Vihvilainen?
Elite prospects?
Veini Vihvilainen.
Sure, all coming over to compete for the starting spot.
Even if all the free agents go, post-Werenski extension, that's still a lot of money for Kekalainen and the Jackets to play with.
Now that they've gotten a taste of this playoff sweetness, I wouldn't be surprised to see Yarmo load up this team and go for it again. With the Wings teetering in mediocrity for the better part of the last decade, I've kind of been conditioned to have a sell-first mentality and build for the future. Believe me, I have my reasons.
But with how Columbus organically built that core, nurtured it with stability, and created an opportunity for themselves to deal from a position of strength, when the time comes, I'll probably find myself asking, why not?